In other words, did he?
When I was after, right away the baby died. He didn't give him time to do tshuva. So this innocent baby.
We don't know really how long did he do tshuva, if he did it 7 days or what, because the baby died, that's what seven days.
See, when I daven and everything, I always ask for Makila. I don't know, I'm doing something, you know, not purposely, but, you know. And I should have the strength to cope with what's here in the morning. That's.
You leaving?
That it is. I'm going for Hashem. That's what my daughter, she used to give her babies red bendles. You believe in red bendles?
I believe in red bendles as much as I believe in the practice that the Noel used to bring to us.
You have it, I don't have that several.
Yeah. See, my attitude is, I'm in a Shemaya.
Okay, where you will.
So if somebody loses a baby, that's gotta kill. No, more than, no, knowing this.
And yet you know the halachas that you don't mourn for that child.
I know.
There's no avails in that situation.
I'm sorry, but, you know, maybe he has something.
Okay, we will wait a moment or two and then we'll get underway. Okay. That's why we usually end a class at 10 of and the next class starts on the one ends on 10 of the hour and the other is supposed to start on the hour.
We keep you another 10 minutes if you want.
Anybody there on Zoom? We'll see. I don't know.
I like it better being here than on a Zoom.
Well, I'm glad to hear that.
I do. You have your telephone is Zoom on.
Most programs are on that Zoom.
Okay. Numbers are a little schwach this morning.
The other problems are not. On Zoom, not. Right. On Zoom. That's why you can hear it on the phone.
Okay, so I'm going to. I'm going to start with our bracha, and then we'll get underway. All right. Baruch Atadonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Asher Kedeshenu B'Mitzvotav V'Tzivanu La'asok B'Divrei Torah. So I'm sort of going to make today a transition to sort of finish up a little bit of our discussion on how Rashi's influence affected Parshanut, Torah interpretation. And then we're going to get into what I felt was an interesting perspective as to the question that Rashi's approach actually impacted on non-Jewish Bible interpretation as well.
You see, the people at that time read our Bible?
Well, of course, they did. First of all, we know that even earlier, they were familiar. Remember, we have a term that we call Tanakh, Bible, right? Torah Nevi'im Ketuvim. Okay, they have a different term for that same set of books.
Really? So they right? used it.
So they were familiar with that. Okay?
Do we have, I don't have the sheet. Do we need the sheets for us?
Well, basically, it was the clergy.
It was the clergy, but there were probably some common people, if they knew how to read, right? Could read. So we spoke about the fact that Rashi's grandson, Rashbam, okay, was an important commentary. Okay, and he more or less, we suggested, followed in his grandfather's footsteps. Why do I say more or less? Because we know a couple of situations, okay, where it's very clear that Rashbam, Rabbi Shmuel ben Meir, had the opportunity to study directly with his grandfather, that Rashi himself did not know Latin, but Rashbam did, and that as a result, he sort of maintained, and if we want to use the term, solidified this approach of Rashi to be a Pashtan, okay, a commentary that focused on the Pshat, on the simple basic meaning of the text. In fact, we do actually have a statement, and I didn't print it out for us. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, where Rashi tells Rashbam, had, and remember, this is already Rashi's, in a sense, at an advanced age, that if I had the time, I would write another commentary, more on Pshat, even more based on simple meaning than what I've written so far.
Rashi said that?
Rashi said that, and this is what Rashbam quotes in his commentary, okay, indicating that that is the case, right? That, and their part of their argument was that Rashi used, according to Rashbam, too much Midrash in his commentary, okay, in that case. Now, the fact, as I said, that he had the opportunity to study with him is important, but, and normally we think of Rashbam primarily as a biblical commentary, okay? And continuing in that, let's call it the school of Rashi, okay, which was later picked up, which we said the other day was Rabbi Joseph Bechor Shor, and ultimately by Ralbag, Rabbi Levi Ben Gershon, okay? So, but we should not forget the fact that there are parts of the Gemara where Rashi did not finish his commentary, and that was written by Rashbam. Okay. And he specifically cites, again, places where here my grandfather passed in his commentary, and he completes that, okay? But I wanted us to be aware of the fact that Rashbam continued that train or that style of commentary, that as a result of his knowing Latin, he was able to read, whether it was Jerome or other Christian, Catholic, basically, commentaries, understand them, okay, disagree with them. Okay. We did not go into detail, by the way, in a lot of Rashi's commentary on Tehillim, for example. That would be a course in and of itself, okay? Just to look at Tehillim and to see Rashi's commentary and ask to what degree were many of his comments polemics, anti-Christian, anti-Catholic, or responses to what Catholic interpretation could have been, okay? And we should know, however, that he engaged Rashbam in discussions with Christian clergy, and that when Rashi, at Rashi's demise, at his passing, Rashbam became the head of the yeshiva there in Troy, and the head of the Jewish community there, okay? So I want us to understand then that the Rashi style as a mefaresh, as a commentary, was very significant and had a strong impact on Jewish Bible commentary to follow for generations. Yes.
What happened to Rashi's son?
To Rashi's son?
His grandson.
He had daughters. Oh, yeah. Okay, he didn't have sons.
I have the book about
Okay, he had daughters. Okay. actually, two of his daughters married two of his students, of Rashi's students. Third daughter apparently got divorced. Okay, and we don't know much more about her.
Yeah, she was.
But his son-in-law became something.
Yes, yes, his sons-in-law were, when we're going to talk a little bit more another week about Tosafot, okay, and who they were and what their framework was. In a sense, many historians want to claim that Rashbam's father, Meir ben Shmuel, was actually the first one to be considered the, I wouldn't call it the founder, but was the one who established the approach by which later generations of scholars would follow. And that became who we called Tosafot. Okay, so we will touch on that a little bit, because, but today I want to, as I say, go with the, continue the biblical area. Another time we're going to, next time we'll talk about the Talmudic strain or the Talmudic path, and that's where we'll deal more with Tosafot. Okay? All right, so we could ask basically the question, how do we know then that Rashi had an influence? Well, we say we still study him today. Okay? Generally, when you first learn Chumash, okay, the idea of an educated Jew, okay, throughout the late Middle Ages, throughout Europe, Eastern Europe, was a Jew who learned Chumash with Rashi. Okay? It wasn't enough simply to learn Chumash and to know Chumash. It meant you learned Rashi along with it. Okay? And that's still really, that was, so to speak, the minimum requirement for somebody to be considered an educated Jew. Now, what about the Gentiles? Okay.